I'm Dan Marotti.
And I'm Mr. USA, WWE Hall of Famer Tony Atlas, munching away on some chicken over here.
It's Christmas Eve. The Hoffer is back for a brand new Wrestling Insiders.
Cheer. Why, hello. I would ask what was on your mind, but I already know. You want to know what has got my beard looking oh so majestic. And I'll tell you, it's sexy as hell beard care. Coconut oil, vitamin E oil, almond oil, both sweet and bitter, shea butter, it's all natural. Yes, JTG has actually come out with a high quality product. So support your boy by going to sahbeardcare.com and take one step closer to becoming sexy as hell. Cheer. Ooh, cheer. You know?
This is Mick Foley.
This is Harley Race.
This is Shelton Benjamin.
This is Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff.
This is the Monster Abyss.
And this is Daniel Bryan.
This is JBL, and you're watching the MWF.
Be there live.
Wrestling fans around the corner, around the world, welcome to a brand new Wrestling Insiders. It's Christmas Eve, Tony. Can you feel it? Can you feel that spirit in the air?
From my toes to the tip of my head, I feel all this excitement because this weekend, right here in Melrose, I've been down here many times to do Boston Wrestling. But now, Boston Wrestling, it's going to have a wrestling show. We're going to have wrestling. We're going to have talking. We're going to have interview. We're going to have photo op. We're going to have picture signing. We're going to have everything all wrapped up in one big package. And you, the fans, is going to be able to open up that big gift of Boston Wrestling right there live. We're going to do a live
Memorial live Hall in Melrose, baby. Two blocks down the street.
Two blocks
that
away.
Tony, it's unbelievable. For the fans, you know, they always say, how can we help? How can we reach out? And believe me, we're going to talk about that in this episode. We do need some help. But if you go to the event page on bostonwrestling.com, if you're not in the Northeast and you still want to help and feel like you're being a little part of what we do, at the bottom of the page, there's a donate button. If you use that to purchase a ticket, the ticket that you purchase is donated to a great nonprofit organization like Make-A-Wish, like Special Olympics. And to give these kids a great night out, it's a great way for fans to help us make these shows come to life. And it's a great way for the fans to give back to the community like we always try
right.
to do.
And you know, Mark Henry went to Iraq many, many times to entertain the kids and do fundraising for the veteran. So Mark Henry is a great guy. Huge. I mean, he's about the size of a house. But he went to every year. He went to Iraq to entertain our troop. And I salute him for that. Now Mark Henry is taking giving up his Christmas to come here to entertain the fans right here in Melrose. So I'm looking forward to see my old friend Mark Henry and a guy that helped get me into the business, a guy that I traveled up and down the road with many, many times, Jerry Briscoe, one of the greatest wrestlers, along with his brother Jack Briscoe, who is deceased, unfortunately. But Jerry's going to be there, former world champion. Mark Henry, a former Olympia champion, former ECW world champion, and Tony Atlas, one half of the WWE first black tag team championship. So you're going to have a lot of champions there. Everborn won a lot of championship. So we got a great, great card. Vicky Guerrero, you know.
Excuse me?
Vicky Guerrero going to be there,
excuse
right?
Me?
Excuse me?
Excuse me?
Going to be there, baby. She's going to excuse herself. But Vicky Guerrero is a wonderful woman, very fan-friendly. And you know, her husband, all y'all know, Eddie Guerrero, was an outstanding wrestler. And Vicky is just an outstanding and a husband. And she's a very fan-friendly person. So I think your fans, you're going to get your money worth. This is going to be one exciting evening. Let me tell you, this is going to be just as good, if not better, than anything you're going to see on television, because you're going to get up close and in person. It's not going to be no security guard pushing you back. It's not going to be no similar land.
You can go to the guardrails and give someone five.
Exactly, exactly. It ain't going to be none of that. The fans, if you would say, hey, Tony, do the laugh for me. You're going to get it, baby. Hey, Tony, give me the autograph. You're going to get it. Hey, Mark Henry, can I take a picture with you? You're going to get it. The fans are number one. We're not doing this for ourselves. We're doing it for a great cause, and we're doing it because we love each and every one of y'all. And Mark Henry is coming all the way up here from Texas just to entertain you, because he said he can't wait to meet all the wonderful fans up here.
And not only are we going to have those featured superstars you mentioned, along with TJP, the first man to ever hold this WWE Cruiserweight Championship.
Wow.
But look at some of the hungry young athletes, Tony, that are going to be there that want to get where you are, where Mark Henry is, where
right.
Vicky Guerrero has been. You're talking about Ring of Honor's Brian Malone, 6'3", 380 pounds. He's a monster. You're talking about Brian Pillman Jr., the son of the late, great Brian
wow.
Pillman, is going to be here in the Millennium Wrestling Federation. Lance Anawahi has signed on to make his MWF
wow.
debut. He's the grandson of Afa,
yeah.
the son of Samu.
Yeah.
He's going to see action here in the Millennium Wrestling
wow.
Federation.
Wow, just keep on getting butter and butter.
Fans, again, for more information, head on over to bostonwrestling.com. You're going to have the wrestling time of your life. Forget about the sports entertainment nonsense. We're going to bring to you a very interactive, a very engaging night of good old professional wrestling. Can we say those two words?
The way it used to be.
Professional wrestling. Myself, Dr. David Reese, our president, the chairman, Neil Manolian. Tony, you've been very involved in the process for this event. We want to give you guys, seriously, a night you're going to feel like you got value for every penny you spent to be there, and we want you to not just go home and forget about it in a couple of weeks. A couple of years from now, we want you to be clicking through those pictures and saying, my God, wasn't that great? Wasn't it great to meet Tony? Wasn't it great to meet Mark Henry? This really was a great experience, and we're trying to bring it to life here in Melrose. We cannot produce these events without the fan support.
That's right. We need you fans. You know, y'all, fans are number one to us. Without the fans, there's no Hulk Hogan, there's no Tony Atlas, there's no John Cena. Y'all the one that make us, and we want to do this, and we want to make sure that each and every fan come in and have the time of their life, and have all the access to everything, autograph, picture taking. And you can make a donation, like I said, because you're giving to a great cause. But if you can't, get there early. Early bird, get the worm.
Tony, you're 100% right about that. All right, Tony, we've done the big pitch for the live event. It's going to be circulating on the graphics throughout this program. We really want you to get involved. It's not a lie. We don't have a WWE budget. We need the help of every single fan that comes our way. And let me tell you this. We appreciate it. We're not going to, I hate to throw people in there, but we're not going to false advertise main events. We're not just going to throw matches in commercials to try and get you to come out. We're working like dogs to try and get you guys to enjoy this show. Maybe some fans can read between the lines that have gone to certain major league events where they go and the advertised main event doesn't take place. The advertised top superstars don't show up. And that's a great disappointment. Let me tell you, we've purchased the airline tickets. We know the hotels. We've paid some of the bills already. We know who's coming to town, and it's those great six superstars that are on the poster, along with, again, these hungry young athletes for a spectacular night, Tony. The fans only deserve our respect, because if we don't respect you, you won't respect us. And
exactly.
That's important to us.
Exactly. And you know, I go everywhere, people ask me, say, Tony, I used to like wrestling. I still like wrestling, but I like wrestling the way you guys did it a lot better. Well, at Melrose, you're going to see some new school wrestling. You're going to see some old school wrestling. You're going to see a little bit of everything. So we got something for everybody. If you like old school wrestling, we're going to have it. If you like high flying, action packed wrestling matches, we got that too. If you want something that you see with Vince, you're going to get that too. So whatever you like, we're going to be like Walmart.
Be like Walmart,
one,
really?
One store stop. We're going to be just like Walmart. This is going to be a Walmart show. If something for your car, something for your house, something for everybody there. It's going to be a wonderful night. Nobody is forgotten about. We there for you people, and we got something for everybody.
All right, Tony. It is Christmas Eve. We've done the big pitch for the event now. Fans have wanted to know where you've been. We always like to catch up when you've been away for a while. It's probably been a little over 6 weeks since you've been here with us. As we've noted to fans many times, when we try and push merchandise, when we try and push live events, you know, it takes a lot to put these lights on. It isn't free. It isn't cheap. Without fan support, we can't even bring this talk show to life.
Well, you know, Dan, because of my exposure here on Boston Wrestling, a lot of people down south and out west and in other places, they're able to watch Boston Wrestling, and they really, really enjoy the program. And so a lot of people have been asking me to come to their area in order to perform and to do stuff. So I've been traveling a lot outside of the Northeast, you know, going to North Carolina, the Los Angeles, and other places. So I've been taking a lot of flights. But it's all because of Boston Wrestling, because the people, this is one of the number one programs out here, and people really get to enjoy talking. And they like to hear more of these stories about how wrestling used to be and where wrestling is going today. You know, they got the new group just started with Cody Rhodes, just started a new group. Yep. And then Ring of Honor is coming up the ladder.
Well, they may be going down, but that's a different story for a different time.
What happened with them?
They're going down. They're going in the opposite direction.
My goodness.
The times are a little tough for Ring of Honor right now.
Oh, my goodness. Well, but in Melrose, it ain't no going down, because I see nothing but up for us.
Let me tell you something, brother. If it snows, the snow's going to melt instantly. The building's going to be so hot
night. That's right.
It's going to be a wild night.
Right. Well, we are New Englanders.
Yeah.
So we're used to snow. I mean, you know, by now, we're used to the snow. And it, like I say, plenty of parking. The building
Free
ain't
parking.
Snowing inside the building. And you don't have that far to go, especially people live right here, you know, in this close by. You know, and it's not a bad trip for me. I'm just a couple of hours away. I just leave early and make sure I'm here on time.
That's all you can do.
But I will be there on time.
You're always on time.
Yep, I love
it. Like a bad penny, you always turn up.
So much excitement is going to go on. There's so many great people. And like I say, I can't stop talking about it enough. It's going to be wonderful to work with Mark Hendrick.
It is.
Again.
It's going to be almost a reunion of you guys. It's
right.
been a while
you know, a lot
since
of people
you've
ask
up.
Me, they say, Tony, what made Vince McMahon bring you back to manage Mark Hendrick? I say, if you watch my introduction when I got inducted in WWE Hall of Fame, and you watch Mark Hendrick, he was like a kid in a candy store, and which I didn't understand. Mark Hendrick told me, I hope he don't get mad at it. He said, Tony, you was one of the guys that got me involved in weight training.
Really?
He said, when I saw you, he said, all I want to do is be big and strong like Tony Atlas.
Wow,
I never knew that. And that was quite a compliment. So it's going to be good to see this big bull. Again, he's an amazing athlete. I would say one of the greatest athletes in the world. You got to realize this is a man that represents America, the United States of America, in the Olympics. He went to the Olympics, and we hadn't had that type of reputation since the 70s when Ken Patero won it.
Not Patero Rustani.
Yeah, Ken Patero.
Ken
Patero. Ken Patero was the last person that won any medal whatsoever in weightlifting. And Mark Hendrick came along after Ken Patero, and there hadn't been nobody to say. So there's only been three people that dominated that field, and that was America. That was Paul Anderson, Ken Patero, and Mark Hendrick.
Wow.
So these are the only
Some
three people that dominate America. The most have the Olympic weightlifting is dominated either by the Japanese or the Russians. The Russians always dominate weightlifting. But with Mark Hendrick was there was no domination. When Ken Patero was there, no domination. When Paul Anderson was there, no domination. So Mark Hendrick, there's only two other people other than Mark Hendrick that represent the super heavyweight in weightlifting. And you fans, you're going to get to meet him this weekend in Melrose. One of the strongest men to ever walk the face of the earth. And I may add, one of the nicest people you ever want to meet in your life.
Great guy, fans. If you missed the interview that I conducted with Mark Henry back in October, check out youtube.com/BostonWrestlingCom. You can find it in the archives. It was great to sit down with Mark at the Christopher Nowinski Concussion Dinner in Boston. We were with President Dr. David Reese. We had a great time. It was good to see Mark. Lacey Evans from WWE was roaming around there that night. It was a nice dinner. Tony, I'll say this for the fans of the talk show. Again, if you're in the Boston area, VIPs, we're going to do this show live in the ring with Mark Henry, with Vicky Guerrero. And we're going to, at one point, we're going to take questions from the VIP fans in attendance.
That'll be
you
great.
Talk about fun.
That'll be great.
We've never done it in a ring. We've only done it here in the studio.
Yep. Everything you see in person, it brings things to life. You know, because you become a part of it. When we do it with you, you are part of it. when you know when you see something on television, the person is in California, you in Boston, so is the, you don't have that connection. But when you eye to eye, can reach out and test the audience. You feel like you are part of it. And like you said, there's going to be questions. You can't ask me a question right now, but you can ask me a question that night. And for all those that want to know what wrestling was really, 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 really like down south, out in Texas, we got Jerry Briscoe. And he's going to be doing a seminar, not just for the wrestlers to learn things, but anybody that would like to learn more about the inside and out of pro wrestling. Jerry Briscoe is your man. He worked with the WWE for many years.
He's still there
in
now.
The office. He's with them right now. He's one of the organizers with WWE. So Vince
McMahon.
He's
a Full Sail University for the NXT tapings
exactly.
every week.
Yeah. So Vince McMahon goes to this guy for advice. So if Vince McMahon, the owner of the WWE, and Stephanie McMahon and Triple H, the owners of the WWE, go to this person for advice, it's there for you too. All you got to do is come there. And you can meet one of the greatest minds in pro wrestling, Jerry Briscoe. You don't want to miss this guy. You don't want to miss this. You don't want to miss what he got to say. You don't want to miss meeting him because he's one of the all-time great for many years.
Well, Tony, like I said, I've really been looking forward to this event. I know you and I, it was probably right around the time your wife suffered her stroke. You and I started to put this great event together.
Yes.
And almost 6 months later, it's finally coming to life. It's going to be really exciting. Again, to be able to do this talk show in front of live people in a live audience with a wrestling ring is going to be really cool. Again, bostonwrestling.com. You can be there live with us, support a great cause, and create some memories you won't soon forget. But Tony, the fans want to know here on Christmas Eve, how have you been? What's going on up in Maine?
Well, I'm doing the same thing I've been doing in Maine since I've been there. I do a lot of work with mentally challenged adults, which is heartwarming. I work a lot with troubled kids through the police department, the probation department. And I try to spend as much time as I can sitting with my wife at the hospital. As y'all know, back in June, the summer of 2019, she suffered from a severe stroke. But by the grace of God, she's recovering very, very good. Not as quickly as I would like for her to be, but both of us, we strong believer in God, and we believe whatever we put in his hand, he's going to help us. So he has really, really blessed my wife a lot. She's able to move her leg a little bit, able to move her arm a little bit. She's fussing at me, so she's getting better.
That's how you can tell when she's feeling She's fussing at you.
So she's getting a lot of butter. But with a lot of people, I would thank all you people out here that sung calls and letters and put my wife in your prayers. So keep praying for her. She's a wonderful, wonderful woman. You know, she loves our country. She's a patriot. She's just a wonderful person. She would give you the shirt off her back. She never had an ill word to say about anyone. She's a great person. I would like to see her to recover and come back home because it's very lonely for me without her. I mean, I've been with this woman for over 30 years, and the last 30 years of my life I owe to this woman. As y'all know from reading my book, Too Much Too Soon, you know, I developed a very bad drug problem. She got me cleaned out. I didn't have to go to rehab. I had to go to Monica. She got me built back up in order for me to Vince McMahon to take me back to do Saba Seba. So one year before y'all saw me debut with The Undertaker back in 1990, 1 year before that, 1989, 1 year after the murder of Bruiser Brody, 1 year before the debut of Saba Seba, Tony Atlas was sleeping on a park bench, eating out of a dumpster when a woman took him off the park bench, brushed him off, and took him home and put him back to where I am now. So the last 30 years of my life, I owe completely to two people here on earth, and that's Vince McMahon Jr. and my wife, Monica Durang White.
Well, that's a really nice feeling to have, Tony.
Yeah, that's why I have no ill feeling.
A lot of respect for your
no
wife.
No ill feeling towards Vince at all. I know a lot
depends
of guys.
Depends on the day of the week.
A lot of guys bad mouth him and everything. But I put in my book, Vince never fired anybody that didn't deserve it. Never fired anybody that didn't deserve it. Vince never really fired anybody. You had to fire yourself. Because he put in the contract each and everything he expect of his wrestlers. And if you violate the contract, then you can't blame Vince for your dismissal. You're going to blame yourself because you knew what the rules were before you went into the game. So if anybody got fired from the WWE, they fired themselves. Tony Atlas fired Tony Atlas. Vince McMahon hired Tony Atlas. Tony Atlas fired Tony Atlas.
All right. Well,
and that's the truth. Self-responsibility is what I believe in. I don't believe in blaming anybody for decisions that I made because we all are the captain of our own ship.
That's a great thought.
And you can't fix nothing if it's not broken. So if you don't feel there's anything wrong with you, you don't feel there's anything to be fixed. So you're going to keep on doing it. But the only way you're going to make up to and straighten up and do right, what my wife taught me, you have to take responsibility of your own mistakes in life. Take credit where credit need to be taken, but also take blame when blame is also needed. Don't take the credit and pass on the blame. You have to take both. Keep the balance, baby, keep the balance. And my wife, she won't be able to come there this weekend, but she's rooting for me, and she give each and every one of y'all her love, and she want y'all to come out and donate and be a part of this because we're all one big family. The family, the wrestling family is right here. It's going to be right here in Melrose on the 28th of December.
We continue to send our thoughts, well wishes, prayers, if you're a spiritual person, to Monica White up in Maine. We want to see her get better. We'd love to have her down in the studio sometime.
She always said that. She said when she first day she get well, she want to come down.
She's going to come with us.
Right, but she want to meet you because of she have watched Boston Wrestling. And she have seen all the wonderful things, not only that you have said and done for her, you have done fundraisers to help her out well with her medical bill, but she also think that you have a very good nature to not only do just for her, but you also have reached out and to others in need. And Dan, that is something that she want to walk up to you and shake your hand about because she had watched Boston Wrestling and she know the wonderful thing that Boston Wrestling had done. That's why you fan, you have to support this because it give old wrestlers like me a living. The Aaron Sheik, Paul Burrow, all of us guys that have been on Boston Wrestling, we can't wait to come back again because we know that what we do don't just benefit us in our career, but it's always a benefit attached to it. We help people that need coats. We help people that need food. We help people that need shelter. We help people that is need. And what make America great is one America helping another America. As we work together as a family, as a team, because we are Team America.
Well, as they like to say, Tony, one hand washes the other, and they both wash the face.
Yep. And that's what made America great. We help each other.
Washing the face.
We look out to each other. We protect each other.
All right, Tony, Christmas Eve tonight, the big day tomorrow. Do you have any plans to have maybe a special meal? Are you and Monica going to dine something nice for the holiday?
Well, I was going to make a roast duck.
Mm-hmm. And bring it to the hospital?
Well, the wife don't like duck.
Well, that might not be a good
thing. Well, I could cook food and take it to her.
Yeah.
Oh, they allow me to bring food in with her. So it's kind of up to Monica. Whatever Monica decide that she want for Christmas, I'm going to get it for her.
Have you finished your holiday shopping at this point?
No, ain't even got started yet. I ain't even got started yet. I like the excitement of it.
The excitement of getting it at the last minute.
Yeah, with all the people is out and the running and the rushing. I just enjoy that. For some, most people like to get it early so they could avoid the rush. But what I learned, the closer it is to Christmas, I had a buddy of mine. I went and bought an exercise bike.
Yeah.
For my little home gym. And I think I paid like $169 for it. And my buddy saw it. He said, I got one just like that. I said, yeah. He said, I paid $300 for it.
Wow.
I said, where you get yours? He told me where he got. We got in the same place. What they do when they get closer and closer and closer to Christmas, they start dropping prices to get rid of them. Because they got the new stuff coming in for the new year, after the new year. So they want to get rid of all the stuff. And so you find yourself a lot of good deals. You can save sometimes. But I just like the excitement of Christmas. It just makes me feel good to be out in the traffic.
I always get disappointed that when it's over, I miss the music, I miss the lights. People are sometimes in a better mood in general around Christmas time. And then on December 26th, it's like, turn out the lights, the party's over. But much like you, I like to do the Black Friday every year. I like the, you can save a decent coin like you just mentioned. But this year, I think I told you, out of nowhere, with Linda Marotti and little baby Marotti, we went down south to Disney World and Universal Studios very right. unexpectedly. So I didn't get to do my Black Friday. This is the first year I've done almost all of my Christmas shopping on the internet. And to me, it's different than being able to go to the store and be around people. And again, you know, you have the lights, you have the music, and so on and so forth. And it's different doing it on the computer than in person. Right. Yeah.
Well, you know, most people, like I live in Maine, and most New Englanders, not just Maine, but most people in New England, the 25th is only the beginning of the celebration. We don't see it in Maine as the end of the celebration. It's the beginning of the celebration. Christmas Eve kicks everything off. Then you got the 26th, the 27th, and 28th. You're going to have wrestling shows. You're going to have music concert go to. The kids is out of school. So everybody's going to be looking for something to do. And the 28th on Saturday, when you find yourself with nothing to do and the kids around the house, come on down to the wrestling show. Meet Mark Henry. Meet Tony Atlas. Come and meet all of us guys. So the 28th, if your fans said, boy, you think the holiday is all over with, it ain't over with. Because after Christmas, you got 26, 27. You got 3 days.
To get ready.
To get ready to see the Pandemonium, one of the greatest shows on earth right here at Melrose. So this Christmas, thanks to Dan, is not going to be left without nothing to do. A lot of people is going to be promoting a lot of stuff, but save your money. You got 3 days to go to rest up to come and see one of the greatest shows in Melrose. It may not be another one coming to Melrose for another year or two. So take advantage of this one.
Look at this, Tony. Look at how much it costs to go to the movie theater in 2019.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you're talking about for a few dollars more, I should say, you get hours of live action-packed professional wrestling, a chance to get autographs and photos, VIPs again. They get to take part in our live talk show. They get a group photo with every superstar that's featured on the poster. It's a great deal, a great price. You get the best seats in the house. We have the charity auctions, thanks to our friends at WWE. We're going to have a great winner-take-all merchandise raffle. It's a very interactive experience. I don't want to knock with larger wrestling companies sometimes, how they go about doing things. WWE is a monster compared to what we do. We couldn't present what WWE does, and because WWE is so large, they can't present events the way that we do. So it's very different. And most fans will probably like both. But if you like to get up close and personal with the wrestlers, have a chance to talk to them for a few moments, not be rushed through a line like, you know, cattle, it's a very fun night out if you've never been with us. And the fans that have, leave some comments in the comment section below if you're on Facebook or on Twitter. We have a lot of great fans that have been with us for so long that we appreciate so much. They're like our extended family. Tell these fans what it's like to come out to a Boston Wrestling MWF live event. It's a great experience, and again, we want to give fans the best value in professional wrestling because we truly appreciate you coming out and giving us your time and money. We need you.
Yes, we do. It's going to be a wonderful holiday. So don't look at the 25th and be the end of Christmas.
It's just the beginning.
It's just the beginning.
Tony, we heard from a good friend of ours down in Palm Bay, Florida, Reno Chastain. He wanted to know, Tony, what would you put on your list this year for Santa Claus?
For Santa Claus?
Yes.
What do you want me to give Santa?
What would you want from Santa Claus if he came up to Auburn, Maine to visit you? I know you're a little old, maybe by a year or two.
What would I want from Santa?
A little Lanny Poffo treatment.
No, I don't want. No. I don't want no wrapping your private part around your wrist or
that might be for the best.
Or giving yourself a head job. Yeah. I don't want that for Christmas. I don't want nothing like that. To be
maybe
honest
New
with
Year's.
You, I would do what I want for Christmas. It's for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ and God, to bless those that is less fortunate than myself. I have been blessed in many, many ways over. I came up hard, poor, and because I live in a great nation, one of the greatest nations in the history of the world, I was able to become a success. Well, because of my irresponsible ways, I lost that success. But then, because I live in a great nation as America, I was able to rebuild myself through the trust of God. So if what I want for Christmas is for my country to grow and for every person to have happiness and have love and respect for each other. We live in a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful country. And I would like for CRISPR, for each and every American, to stop bad-mouthing America, stop looking down on her, but love her, respect her, love your neighbors, as the Bible said. Respect your neighbor, respect yourself. What I would want for CRISPR is love throughout the world, but especially in a country that I love so much, the United States of America. So be happy that you live in this country. Be blessed that you live in this country. You could talk bad about your president, you could talk bad about your leaders, but you do have that right. And with a lot of countries, you don't have that right. We have people, we have safety nets for those who can't help themselves. Those who have, America always been a very giving country. We're all Christians here. And as Christians, as America, we help each other. And when Dad found out that I was having hard times, Dad came to my rescue. When he heard that another person having a hard time, he had one guy was sleeping out of his car. Nobody to help him.
The puppet.
Yeah, Dad came and helped this guy. He's a true American. When I was down eating out of garbage can, Vince McMahon called me up and gave me a job. He's a wonderful American. We got to what anybody say about Vince McMahon Jr. I think he's a wonderful man. When I thought nobody loved me, I found an American woman that took me in, nursed me back to health. America is a wonderful, wonderful country. And what I want for Christmas is for God to bless the United States of America.
Tony, that's a very nice statement.
I owe my country. Everything I got, I owe to this country. Imagine if I was born in Africa, if I was born anywhere but America, would I be a Hall of Famer? Would I be Mr. USA? Would I be Mr. Universe?
If you were born outside of the USA, would I get not only got
a second chance with the WWE, I got a third and fourth chance with the WWE. He called me back again to manage Mark Henry. He called me back again to do Legend House.
You might get a fifth for all you know. You never know.
It'd be a blessing.
You never know.
It'd be an absolute blessing. But he called me back several times. So I have been blessed many, many times because I live in a nation where opportunities are sitting there waiting on us. Only thing we have to do is to work hard, keep our nose clean, and look. The Bible says, knock and the door shall open. Seek and ye shall find. The reason most of us don't make it, we give up on ourselves. We give up on our country. We give up on our government. There's nothing wrong with the American government. There's nothing wrong with America in itself. If America is such a bad place, why is everybody trying to get here? I don't see nobody leaving America, going to Mexico. I don't see nobody leaving America, going to Canada, going to Africa, going anywhere else. But what I do see, everybody is trying to run here because they know this is the best of the best, the beast of the east, SOS, simply out of sight. There's nothing like it. Often imitated, but never duplicated. America is the best, and we know it, and we are the best people because we don't only take care of Americans, we take care of other countries. There's a lot of countries that won't survive without America. There's a lot of countries, the world is not safe without America. So me and Dan, on the 28th, right here in Melrose, we want to give back to our country. We're not just doing this for ourselves. We're doing it for the fans, our American fans, that we feel that we need to do something special for all those that have worked hard to build this great nation into what it is. And so on the 28th, right here in Melrose, me and Dan, we're going to say to all you American wrestling fans, and those, you don't even have to be a wrestling fan to come and enjoy the show.
Not at all.
Come on out. If you never saw a wrestling match before, this is your chance to watch. This is your chance. And my offer still goes. Gronkowski, if you out there anywhere, Gronkowski, and you come to the show in Melrose, I'm going to body slam you.
You challenge Gronk.
I challenge Brock.
Brock or Gronk?
Bronk. What's his name? Gronkowski.
Gronkowski.
Gronkowski?
Yeah.
I'm going to body slam him because he wasn't there to help Brady.
All right. Well,
He ran out on Brady, and I want to body slam. You come on down, Gronk. I'm ready for you, baby. And if you win, you can have my new jacket.
Well, I don't think you want to give that away. See, Tony, mentioning clothes, it is Christmas time. Caesar the Lion, many fans have commented on that Orlando Magic jersey that you wear a lot. It's a little faded. So,
do you mean faded?
It's a little old, Tony. It looks like circa 1992.
Who are you calling old here, Dan?
I'm talking about the jersey, not you. But we have this, for next time you're here in the studio, Tony, thank you, Cecil. We have this great, it'll make you look very, very handsome, Tony. Nice new shirt for the Atlas wardrobe, so to speak. I don't know if you want to show off the, maybe you'll cut off the sleeves and show off the guns.
Oh, no, no, you don't want to damage
that.
That's
nice,
a beautiful shirt.
That blazer with
and
the...
And what we do, giving this to fans?
No, that's for you.
Oh, thank you, Dad. You see what I'm talking about? This is America. This is only the beginning. This is only the beginning of the holiday. Don't sit around Christmas Day and say, what are we going to do the rest of the week? Well, you come on down to Melrose, and we got a lot for you to do. And in fact, we're all going to be there early for those that like to get in early. We're going to be there way. What time is bell time?
Bell time is at 7 o'clock.
Bell time is 7 o'clock. Tony Atkins is going to be there at 4 o'clock.
All right. Well, I don't know.
Because I want to be there early to meet the fans. And if you want to listen to some of my old stories, I got a whole bunch of them, don't I, Dad?
You have stories, all right.
Oh, boy, I got a whole bunch.
Will you tell the story about Wahoo McDaniel?
You want Wahoo McDaniel?
Yeah.
Paul Jones.
Underground Atlanta.
Underground Atlanta.
I want to hear that
Abdullah
one again.
Abdullah the Butcher. So I got a list and
Tina
list
Turner.
Of wrestlers that people probably never even heard of
no,
before.
Yeah.
Do you know in Canada in 1975, I wrestled against Killer Kowalski?
I didn't know that.
I wrestled in Fort Lauderdale in the 70s against Larry the Axe Hennin,
good friend,
who is
Larry.
Kurt Hennin's father. I wrestled Bob Orton Sr. and Bob Orton Jr., which is the father and grandfather of Randy Orton. I wrestled Peter Maivia, who is the grandfather of The Rock. And I tagged up with The Rock father, which is Rocky Johnson. So a lot of these guys that is wrestling right now, I wrestle against their father. I wrestle against their grandfather.
Wouldn't it be interesting if here in the MWF, if it's, I know he's certainly a fan favorite, but maybe if you teamed with Lance Anoa'i in a tag team match, who is the grandson of Afa, one of
that's
your
right.
former enemies.
That's right.
And the
that's
son
right.
of former head shrinker Samu.
That's right.
You have a long history with those Samoans.
That's right. And with the Fiji. I wrestled with and against
who?
Superfly Fiji. He's from Fiji Island. Superfly just Jimmy Slooker.
Yeah.
Jimmy Slooker. I wrestled with Jimmy Slooker, and I wrestled with and against his son.
Well, that's right. He
that's
was
right.
in WWE.
That's right. His son broke into the business, too. So Jimmy Slooker had a son. And I have never worked with her, but I have spoke to her. I even held her in my arm when she was a baby. And that's Slooker's daughter.
Tamina.
So wrestling had been a family, to me. I met wrestlers that wrestled in the 50s, like Klondike Bill and Abe Jacobs and Johnny Weaver. Now, Johnny Weaver, we don't talk much on him.
No.
But one of the greatest.
Other than what happened with Penny.
One of the greatest brains that I've been in this business was Johnny Weaver. He was a guy that he didn't have much of a body. And in order for him to get over with the wrestling fan, he had to out-wrestle everybody. So couldn't nobody out-wrestle him. And that's how he built his reputation, because he didn't have the big arm. He didn't have the wrestling body, the big broad shoulder, the big thick neck. Had none of that. But he got over like $1 million because he gave the fans 110% every time he went in the ring. And Johnny Weaver is one guy that don't get talked about much. Klondike Bill is another one. Abe Jacob. And the list go on and on. Just like Dominic DiNucci. A lot of people know he was an Olympic champion.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. He represented America in wrestling in the Olympics. He went to the Olympics at back.
I didn't know that.
We have a lot of great athletes that have done other things in other sports, like Black Jack Mulligan, an ex-Marine, ex-football player. Wahoo McDaniel, ex-football player. You know, Vader, God rest his soul.
Leon White,
a two-time Super Bowl champion. Oh, he was on two Super Bowl teams. You know, and these guys, he left. And he said the greatest thing that happened to him was walking into that wrestling ring.
Yeah.
Even though he wore two Super Bowl ring on his finger.
Was it two? I thought it was only one.
Two. No, he had two.
It was two. All right.
No, I seen him. He had two. Yeah, he was on two teams. Yeah, he had two. I seen both of them. Yeah.
All right.
And it was sad that he did not get inducted in a WWE Hall of Fame.
Leon?
Before he passed, because he told me many times, and it brought tears to my eye, that would be one of his greatest accomplishments. He said that WWE ring meant more to him than a Super Bowl ring, because that you earn on your own. Super Bowl ring you earn with a team.
That's a very good point.
But the WWE ring you earn on your own merits.
Well,
nobody helped you get it. You got to get it on your own.
I'm very proud to say that we had Leon here in the studio. He was ill the day we took it. He had quite a cold. We had planned on, you know, having him come back to the studio like you, that's somewhat of a regular.
Yeah.
And, you know, life happens, and he passed away.
It was disappointing. Yeah, it's sad. And I wish my good friend, Special Delivery S.D. Jones, was still alive to be at this show. I know he would have loved to be in Melrose on the 28th of December 2019. He would have loved it. I talked to his wife every Christmas, every Thanksgiving, and she said, it don't get no easier. Every Thanksgiving, she think of her husband. Every Christmas, she think of her husband.
Well, how is Mrs. Jones?
She gets very depressed around the holidays. So if y'all got loved ones that y'all miss, don't sit home and moan. Come on out and enjoy it, because most of us, we have went through the same thing. You know, I lost my mom. I had to witness the horrible slaughter and death of one of the best wrestlers and one of the best friends I've had, Frank Goodish, who we all know as King Kong Bruiser Brody. And when I hear his son on Viceland TV say, everybody has a Bruiser Brody story but me. That is sad that this young man grew up not knowing his father. But we all knew him. But his fresh blood didn't. So there going to be a lot of wrestlers that y'all going to meet along the years, guys like me, guys like Jerry Briscoe, that we here now. But there's no guarantee that we're going to be here next year. So when you get an opportunity to meet somebody like Mark Henry or Jerry Briscoe or Vicky Guerrero, take advantage of it. And believe me, we really appreciate y'all coming out, because without y'all, we are nothing. Y'all is what made us.
You know what fans have asked, Tony? In 2020, they said they'd like to see an episode of this program, a big group interview with myself and you, obviously, but along with Abdullah the Butcher, Savio Vega, and Dutch Mantel. I think that would be a very interesting episode.
I think it'd be wonderful, because each person had worked, in order they'd have what's called territories.
Well, to talk more about the incident in Puerto Rico.
Oh, yes.
We all were there.
Yes. Yes, that would be wonderful, because y'all seen it on Viceland TV. But the thing about most TV,
but have everybody together in everyone in the same room at the same time.
Yeah, but also when they do the documenting, a lot of stuff that Abdullah said, a lot of stuff that Dutch Mantel said, a lot of stuff that I said did not get played. Mm-hmm. See, a lot of stuff get edited out.
I understand.
But when
we
do it live, like what you suggested, it's raw.
This show is almost never edited.
It nothing get edited out. And you can ask detailed questions.
Yep. That's why fans like what we do.
Yeah,
it's
you
raw.
Can ask. Like I told people that I went to the gym with Brody, but that's all they say. What did I talk to Brody about at the gym? What muscle did Brody work? What exercise were we doing that day? How much did Brody lift that day? All these little details get left out of the big documentary.
They only had an hour.
Right.
That's only 42 minutes with commercials.
I was in the ambulance with Brody going to the hospital. What was Brody thinking? What did you say to Brody? What did Brody say to you? How was Brody in the ambulance? None of that got mentioned. They gave you a brief summary that I took him to the hospital. But what happened between leaving the building and the hospital? There's five or six stories right there that never got edited.
Yeah.
That, like you said, if you're doing live, you can get
you
it.
You can't
Dutch
edit it
Mantel
out.
Was not able to tell the story of what happened when he walked back in the dressing room and saw his best friend laying in the ground. What did the wrestler say after Tony Atlas left? All these details have been left. So the story is not fully told. It was told by Viceland TV in one of the best ways, but it's not the whole story. It's not the whole story. What asked Abdullah, what was it like to talk to his wife? And we never talked to Barbara. Barbara, what was it like when you got the call and found out that your husband is no longer there?
Well,
these are all little details that they did a wonderful job. Don't get me wrong.
They only had 42 minutes.
They only had so many minutes to do so much. And you can't fit that whole story into one little package. And by you having this, putting this together that you're discussing, it's going to mean a great deal.
Well, if we're able to do it, it'll be great. The fans have asked for it, and I think we should explore it, if nothing else.
I think it'd be a wonderful idea.
Yeah, I think it'd be fun.
Because you get the little details that you don't get. Because when they write a story, they try to stick to the the basic, you know, the major part of it. And some stuff they may find insignificant, but to someone out there, they may find that very interesting.
Yep. Knock on wood.
Interesting. Yeah, but so some people might find it very interesting that Brody had like 36 inch thigh, and the day I was taught that he was leg pressing 800 pounds for reps. That is not in the story. Brody bench press over 400 pounds. That is not in the story. That's what he was doing that day in the gym.
Sounds like Walter Hillside on a bad day.
Yeah. He was a powerful individual. And a lot of people don't know his background.
We'll see what happens. I'd like to bring it to life here in the studio.
I would love for you to do something like that. I think it'd be absolutely wonderful myself. I think it'd be great.
All right, Tony, we certainly have had a lot to talk about here on Christmas Eve. Not much of it had much to do with Christmas, but welcome to the Nature of the Wrestling Insiders talk show. I know in 2020 you have a lot to look forward to as Tony enjoys. You know, I'd like to see you be maybe the first black Colonel Sanders in those TV commercials.
I'm an American.
You don't want to be Colonel Sanders.
No, I'm not black. I'm not white.
Well, your last name is white.
I'm the only legal white person here.
You are, that's
You're
right.
You're a fake white person.
I'm not a real one.
You're not a real one. My last name is white. So, a human being is the strangest creature God ever made.
It is.
Yes. When a dog come down the street, you know it's a dog. And not only that you know it's a dog, you know what kind it is. You know if it's a pit bull, you know if it's a shepherd, you know if it's a bulldog. You know its character. When you see a cat, not only you know it's a cat, you know what type of cat it is. But when you see a human being, you don't know what you got. Because we wear the mask of humanness. But underneath, you could be a snake. You could be a rat. You could be a thief. You could be anything. You don't really know nobody. And my mother said, I tell you, live with them. That's what makes a human being different than any creature God created. Because you never know. Brody had no idea what type of person Jose was until he put a knife in his belly. We get married. Then all of a sudden, the guy that said, I love you, is going upside his wife's head. She didn't know he was out of it. A human, you have to live with him. And even then, you don't really know him. Because what we are is that we are a spiritual creature. And our real identity is don't show on the outside. It shows on the inside. And the only people that know what we really are is God and us. Because we are a spiritual creature. Animals do not have spirit. We live of the spirit, not of the flesh. That's why life for us is flesh and spirit. Where life for an animal is just spirit, a flesh. Mm-hmm. So you never really know a person until you live with them.
I've heard that phrase before, and I think
because
you're right.
It's true. Yep. Because you can look at a person, may look like the nicest person in the world. You watch all these serial killers they show on TV. People say, oh, I couldn't believe he's such a nice guy. See? An animal show his true nature. You know, a fish got to live the way a fish live. A dog got to live the way a dog live. A cat got to live the way a cat live. A human, God gave a human something he never gave to other animals. He gave us the will of choice.
Good point.
We choose the type of individual we want to be or don't want to be. See? And that what make a human being the most unrecognizable creature on the planet. You cannot go by how they look. You can meet a woman, prettiest woman you ever seen in life. Take her home, worst daggum thing you ever had in your life.
What if they're a three-input woman?
A who?
A three-input woman.
A three-input woman. What input, kind of woman is that?
Input. You know, they keep the back door unlocked.
Well, don't marry her.
All right. No, those aren't ones you keep.
No three-input women. That ain't somebody you want to take home to mom.
No. So if they keep the back door locked, that's marriage material.
Yeah. Front door locked, too.
I don't know about the front door, Tony. You need the front door unlocked.
For me, but not everybody else.
All right.
I had a woman one time.
Back door.
I hope I can say this.
Yes, please.
I had a woman one time, the best sex in the world. She was the best lover I ever met.
Ellen Damsky.
And how did I know this? All my neighbors told me.
What was her name, Tony? Do you remember?
I ain't doing that to her.
What state?
California.
California sex?
Yeah.
Now, how did you meet this California woman?
I met her in bed.
You met her in bed?
Yeah.
You just woke up in some random bed
and
she was there?
Back in the old days, the boys used to have orgies.
Oh, she was a rat?
She was a woman.
She was a woman.
Right. Yeah, because I don't want to call her a rat because to call her one, I got to call me one. Because I was just as doggish as she was. But then I seen women go to my room. He just passed away, God bless his soul. Randy Collins.
Randy Collins was part of this orgy.
Randy Collins. Yep, and you know, when he was young, before he got married and everything, until we found a woman we really love, they're like, we had our fun. It was easy, because one thing that they jumped all over from saying it, but I didn't, because he just told the truth. And that's why I voted for him, and probably going to vote for him again this year. And that's Donald Trump said that when you have money and fame, there are women out there, not all women, but there are women out there that will do whatever you want, simply because you got fame. And it's the same thing, not just women, same thing with men.
Did you ever walk up to someone and just grab their pussy like Donald Trump said? You did. So you walked up to him and he didn't know and said, let me give him a squeeze?
Let me see
if you're ripe?
Yeah, in the 70s. In the
70s. You're at the supermarket.
Right,
yeah.
Right. Well, there was no sexual harassment. They were called flirting.
It was called flirting.
And back then, especially down south, if a woman didn't like what you were doing, she would slap your face. And that was it. It was over with. There was no lawyer, no court, none of the
rigmarole. It was just a slap.
Well, yeah, they would let you know that they were not interested. But a lot of times, I used to go to the ring, and women be grabbing me on the way to the ring. Many a time I got, you know.
You were groped by these women at the arenas.
Many a time I went to the ring with a boner.
Really?
Y'all, the women be grabbing you, stroking you as you're going to the ring. You know
stroke? What wait, there was stroking
put the stroke
going
on you, baby. They put the stroke on that thing, make that thing stand up like a tall soldier. And right, then once Harley Race chopped you, or Wahoo chopped you, it went back there. One chop for Wahoo, Wahoo McDaniel. The way he would chop you, pull the skin off your chest.
The blood was flowing to a different part of the body at that point.
Yeah, all of a sudden, whatever that girl did to you coming to the ring, Mark Wahoo got rid of it. As soon as you got to that way, get one of them chopped. All of a sudden, you forgot about sex and everything else. But no, the people that got fame, got money, unfortunately, one of humans' weaknesses is to put people above us because of their fame and their success. That's what I like about Maine. The thing about Maine is different than any place I've been. Maine put nobody beneath them, but they put nobody above them. I never knew that until I saw an interview that was done by Stephen King. He lives in Bangor, Maine. And they asked him, said, why you live in Maine? And he said, it keep my balance. He said, everywhere I go, people praise me for my books and my movies. He said, but Maine, I get treated like an ordinary person. They don't treat him like a superstar.
You know who he has the same birthday as? Me.
You and Stephen King.
We have the same birthday, September 21st. How about that? How about that?
It'd be nice if y'all had the same pocketbook.
No kidding, right? But let me ask you, I'll run this by you, Tony. I mean, one of our production folks, Cecil the Lion, you know, he had the predicament of a famous celebrity coming up. He didn't get grabbed, but he got pet repeatedly by a certain ring announcer in professional wrestling.
Oh,
so along with fame, sometimes it goes a little too far. You never know.
Well, I'll tell you one thing I learned about fame, too. A lot of times, some people blow out Dale Candace. They light Dale Candace by blowing yours out. Back in 1974 or 75, I was at the YMCA in Charlotte, North Carolina. And I was working out with Gene and Ole Anderson. And the God rest his soul, one of the guys that helped train me, trained Bam Bam Bigelow, the owner of Monster Factory.
Larry Sharp.
Larry Sharp. He was in the gym also with us. And with this guy, he was taking karate. And he would walk around. All them fake wrestlers, they're nothing but a bunch of phonies. I'm in a real sport. They bunch of phonies. So Ole Anderson just got through bench pressing 405 pounds for 5 reps, stood up off the bench. And he said, I get hit pretty hard in the ring. He said, how hard can you hit? He said, I got a punch that would put anybody down. Ole said, yeah, He said, you mean you could hit me in my stomach and you would bend me over? He said, if I hit you in your stomach, Ole. He said, not only are you going to bend over, they're going to have to carry you out of here. And Ole said, okay. So he walked away. He said, I got to go use the bathroom. He said, I want to try your punch. He said, I got to use the bathroom first. He said, I don't want you to hit me in something that I wet on myself. So Ole left out of the weight room, and he came back. He said, hey, karate man, show me that punch you got. The guy said, you really want me to hit you, Ole? He said, I tell you, it's going to hurt. Ole said, I've been hit by Andre the Giant. I've been hit by Harley Race. I've been hit by Wahoo McDaniel. I've been hit by Killer Kowalski. He said, being hit by you is just being hit by another man. Give me your best punch. Shut your freaking mouth and just give me the punch. So Ole said, give it to me right here. Right here. Put it right in there. So the guy said, you sure? Shut your freaking mouth and hit me, you prick. So when the older called him a prick, the guy drew back, hit Ole with his best punch, broke his hand. Ole started laughing. He lifted his shirt, pulled out a 10-pound plate. He put a 10-pound weight underneath his shirt.
How did he ever do that without his pants coming down?
He was holding it. Because he kept telling the guy, flip right here.
Oh, I see.
Hit me right here. And he had this hand there. He said, go ahead. Hit me right here. And the guy drew back and hit Ole. All the wrestlers know this story. And broke his hand. And Ole had a weight. He took one of them 10-pound weight plates and put it underneath his shirt. The guy hit it and broke his hand. And Ole said, not only that karate ain't worth a shit, you're also stupid as shit. You got shit for brain.
Well, Tony, I tell you, it has been.
That's a true story.
I know it's a true
story.
That's
a true story. You can ask any wrestler that was around in Charlotte. That story has been told about in the dressing room for many, many years.
WCW turned it into an angle, I think, in 1999.
No, they did. Did it really?
They did. It was Bret Hart as a heel was feuding with Goldberg. You know how Goldberg did the spear?
Right.
They were up in Canada, and Bret came out with a big hockey jersey and pants, and Goldberg went to charge at him and give him the spear, and when he went into the chest, Goldberg collapsed. Then Bret started laughing. He pulled up the shirt and he took out the weight. They turned it into an angle.
They turned it into an angle.
You love it.
Yeah.
All right, Tony, it has been a tremendous Christmas celebration for us. Again, this Saturday night, if you're in the Boston area, baby, head on over to Melrose Free Parking. You have the commuter rail train. You have the MBTA. You have buses that go right to Memorial Hall. Tony, Mark Henry, Vicky Guerrero, Evan Bourne, Gerald Briscoe, TJP, and a host of others, fans. I don't know how many more times I can say it. I've said it so many times the past 3 months.
And Boston Wrestling Live.
You're going to have our talk show live. You're going to have an autograph photo fan fest. You're going to have in-ring action. And again, there's going to be so much great merchandise available for you to help the Paul Bear Holiday Headlocks Toy Drive. For this man, the Hoffman, Tony Atlas, I'm Dan Moratti. Maybe we're not going to be very PC right now, Tony, but we're going to wish all of you a very
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to all.
And to all a good life.
See you next time. See you Saturday night in Melrose. I'm Dan Moratti.
And I'm John Cena Sr.
Let us tell you how the action and excitement of the Millennium Wrestling Federation can help raise cash for your nonprofit cause. Experience the action and excitement of the Millennium Wrestling Federation live in your city throughout New England, the tri-state area, down through the Carolinas, out to our friends in the Midwest and beyond.
If your nonprofit organization is looking for an interactive turnkey experience while putting the fun into fundraising, you've met the perfect tag team partner to work with every step of the way.
The MWF offers a variety of packages for groups of almost any size, from our live events at the Boston Garden, the Kowloon Entertainment Dining Complex, and the legendary Suffolk Downs, to high school gyms and function halls. We've presented live events everywhere and anywhere.
Since 2001, the MWF's mission has been simple: keep the kids off the streets. Under the leadership of President David Reese, we bring the superstars of yesterday, today, and tomorrow to your town. Not for a wrestling show, but an event that features action-packed in-ring wrestling, autograph, pose photo opportunities, Q&A sessions, and so much more. It's the best of sports and entertainment. The week of your event, we can add on to the endeavor with anti-bullying campaigns, library meet and greet reads, youth sport concussion seminars, and more.
Our live events are fit for fans of any age from 5 to 95. This fall is part of our new Kids Club program, We offer live event experiences exclusively for the youngest of fans. On the flip side, we can produce a tailor-made event for fans of an older demographic as well. We work with you every step of the way to get the word out to fans near and far on our local television offerings and to over 50,000 fans and growing on our social media platforms.
Your success is our success. If your group has had enough of candy bar and wrapping paper sales and has the energy to team with our passionate fan base, bringing the NWF experience to your community is the answer to put smiles on faces while raising cash for your cause.
Contact us today to get the ball rolling for your custom-made event that you'll want to bring back year after year to your community.
Don't just take it from us. Here are the folks we've teamed up with in the past.